In this lecture, we're going to understand how traps are handled in XV6. Please visit this URL for more details on this complete series of lectures on operating systems. So what is a trap? So for most of the time, the CPU executes user programs. But when certain events happen, the user program traps into the operating system or the kernel code, right? So these are called traps whenever the OS needs to be invoked, right? So in general, in any operating system, the following events cause a user process to trap into the kernel, okay? So all of these events together are referred to as traps in XV6. So what are these traps? The first one is system calls. Whenever a user requests the operating system for certain services, the user wants to say open a file or read a file or do something, then the user makes a system call to the operating system. That is a trap. Another example of a trap is an interrupt. An external hardware device wants the attention of the operating system. For example, a packet has arrived on the network card and the network card wants to hand that packet over to the operating system. Then it raises an interrupt. The next kind of traps are what are called program faults. That is, your program has accessed some memory that is not supposed to access. There's a segmentation fault. Some illegal action by the program also causes a trap into the operating system. So when any of the above events happens, the user code execution is stopped and the CPU executes a special instruction called the int instruction, which causes a jump into the operating system code. Now, who invokes this int instruction? For example, in a previous lecture where we studied system calls in XV6, we saw that whenever the user made a system call, some special code in this uses.s, some code in this file invoked the int instruction. It actually called the int instruction whenever a system call related function was invoked, right? So in this way, this int instruction can be explicitly invoked, or for things like hardware interrupts, the device itself can send some signal to the CPU that causes the CPU to run this int instruction. So in whichever way, whenever any of these events happen, the CPU stops whatever it is doing and executes the int n instruction. So note that this instruction has a parameter to it. It is int n. This n is the parameter. This indicates the type of trap or type of interrupt. For example, this value of n will be different for a system call, it will be different for a keyboard interrupt, it will be different for a disk interrupt, and so on, right? A device is assigned a certain number, which is called the IRQ number, and using that number as a parameter, it raises the interrupt. And this causes the CPU to run this trap instruction or the int instruction. So what happens during this trap instruction? So before the trap instruction, your instruction pointer EIP was pointing to some piece of code, your stack pointer ESP was pointing to some location, right? And now suppose this trap occurs. So we will use the terms interrupt, trap, all of these interchangeably, right? So now the trap occurs. Now what happens when the CPU runs int n? The following actions happen. Okay, so first the CPU knows of a data structure called the interrupt descriptor table or IDT, right? A previous lecture has covered this concept already. So the CPU knows the memory address of this IDT. It will go to that IDT and fetch the nth entry of that IDT. So that IDT has multiple entries describing what to do for each interrupt. So because this is int n, it will go look up the nth entry. And then this IDT will have certain pieces of information. So acting upon that, the CPU will first save the stack pointer somewhere and it will switch to the stack pointer corresponding to the kernel stack of the process. Okay, so whenever the kernel is running any code, whenever a trap is being handled, the kernel will not use the user stack, and therefore, so there is the user stack and in the kernel memory, there's a separate kernel stack. So this ESP will switch to pointing to the kernel stack, right? So how does the CPU know the location of the kernel stack? There is another data structure that the CPU knows about called the task state segment that has information about the kernel stack of a process. But don't worry about that for now. Just know that whenever the CPU runs this int n, it can find the kernel stack of the process and switch the stack pointer to the kernel stack. Now on this kernel stack, it will save a few registers, like it will save the old value of the ESP, which was, you know, saved in an internal register. It will save the value of EIP, where the execution stopped when this interrupt occurred. All of that will be saved on the kernel stack. And then now that the old values have been saved, it will once again change the EIP to point to some OS code. Okay, so it will load the new EIP from the IDT. So the IDT has information. If this interrupt occurs, run this code, right? So it will use that IDT entry and point the EIP to the new IDT entry. Okay, so all of this is done by the CPU as part of the int n instruction. So before int n, the CPU was running some code, the stack pointer was pointing somewhere. By the end of the int instruction, the instruction pointer is pointing to the kernel code that handles the interrupt, and the stack pointer is pointing to the kernel stack of the process. And now the OS is ready to run its code to handle the interrupt. Okay. So I've omitted a few details for the sake of simplification. I've just said that the ESP EIP registers are stored. In fact, a few other registers are also saved as part of this int n instruction, like some segment registers and so on. And there are also some CPU privilege checks that are performed when accessing an IDT entry, right? Because a user code, for example, cannot invoke an interrupt pretending to be the disk and invoke the IDT entry of the disk interrupt. So all such checks are done. And also another point to note is if an interrupt already occurs when the kernel is already handling a previous interrupt, right? In which case you don't have to save the stack pointer again because you're anyway on the kernel stack. So there are a few such details about this int n instruction that I've omitted. But the important thing to know is the int n instruction moves the instruction pointer to OS code, moves the stack pointer to the kernel stack, sets the CPU to a high privilege level so that now we are ready to run the OS code to handle the trap. Okay, so now the question comes up, why do we need a separate trap instruction, right? We were already invoking function calls before all of this happened, right? When you have to invoke a function call, you simply jump to the piece of code where the function call is implemented. Similarly, when you have to run a trap, you can simply jump to the OS code, right? So why have a separate instruction to do that? Why not just use the jump instruction, for example? So the reason is that this is not just jumping to new code. A system call or any handling of any trap also involves a change in the privilege level, right? User code runs at a lower privilege level, but the OS code runs at a higher privilege level, right? So therefore, you cannot simply give the address of the kernel code and hope that the user program jumps to the kernel code correctly, sets the kernel stack correctly. All of these cannot be exposed to the user program, right? So you need somebody to take charge of the situation. Whenever a trap occurs, somebody trustworthy to take charge of the situation, to change the CPU privilege level, and you know, to switch to the kernel stack, to switch to the kernel code, to give control to the kernel. All of this, you need someone to do that before the OS can start running. And that someone is basically our CPU, right? So this int n instruction is baked, the logic of this is baked into the silicon, so that the CPU can do all of this automatically whenever some event occurs. Okay, so that is some background on why we need a separate trap instruction. So now, as part of handling the trap, what we need to do is we need to save some state onto the kernel stack of a process before we can do any processing, before we can run any code to handle the trap. So why is that? Now, whenever an interrupt or a trap occurs, you're stopping the execution. Suppose a user program was running, you're stopping that execution. So therefore, the CPU context of where the execution has stopped has to be saved, right? Not just the EIP, ESP, but various other registers have to be saved so that when you return back from the trap, you can resume where you left off, right? So therefore, some state, some CPU context has to be saved when a trap occurs. Okay, so this CPU context is defined in the data structure called the trap frame in x86. Okay, this trap frame is all the fields that must be pushed, saved on the kernel stack before handling a trap, so that all of this can be restored later on. Okay. So in addition to CPU context, some extra information is also saved on the trap frame, like the trap number and things like that, so that the trap handler knows exactly what is happening. So all of this is saved in the trap frame, and this is saved. Where is this trap frame pushed? All the fields of the trap frame are pushed onto the kernel stack. Okay, so the int n instruction has already switched the stack pointer to the kernel stack, and all of this is saved on the kernel stack. So note that the hardware, the int n instruction, already pushes some of these fields, right? So we've seen that it pushes the stack pointer, it pushes the EIP, and a few other things like the segment register and CPU flags. All of these are already pushed by the time you go to the kernel code. By the time the kernel starts its trap handling, a few values are already pushed onto the kernel stack, right? So this is your kernel stack. A few values are already populated onto the kernel stack by the time the kernel starts executing. Okay. So after the int n instruction runs, it has pushed a few things on the kernel stack, and the EIP is pointing to kernel code. And what we are going to see next is the kernel code that runs to handle a trap. So now this is the kernel trap handler code. It is called all traps. So the IDT, the interrupt descriptor table, is set up in such a way that no matter what is the interrupt, all of them point to this same function. This is an assembly language code called all traps, and all IDT vectors point to this function, right? So how is this IDT constructed and all, we're going to omit those details because it's not that important. But all that you need to know is, no matter what the value of n in the int n instruction, no matter what trap happens, the EIP will be set to this function and the kernel starts running from here. Okay. So what does this all traps assembly code do? It will basically go ahead, push more registers onto the kernel stack to save the CPU context. For example, all this DS, ES, everything is pushed. This instruction push all pushes all the general purpose registers, and it changes a few segments, which we won't worry about. But the important thing to know is it builds the trap frame. Okay, so by the time all these registers are pushed, this entire trap frame that we saw on the previous slide, right? All these general purpose registers, all of these are pushed by the kernel all traps code. Okay, so the kernel all traps code pushes all of these registers and builds the trap frame. So until now, what do you have? You have your kernel stack, and you have the entire trap frame has been populated onto your kernel stack, and your stack pointer is now at the top of the kernel stack. Right? So now, of course, trap handling involves a lot of complex things, right? You know, if you have to talk to the disk, you have to talk to the network card. All of these you don't want to write in assembly code, right? You want to write C code. People are more comfortable doing that. So now, after saving the context, after the basic work has been done, this assembly code will simply call a C function called the trap function, right? There are too many traps floating around, but this is actually a call to a C function named trap. And this C function is given an argument. It is invoked like this. It is given the trap frame as an argument. So the trap frame is simply, the pointer to the trap frame is nothing but the top of the stack, right? If you look at the ESP, whatever address it's pointing to, this is the trap frame. Therefore, you push the ESP onto the stack as an argument to this trap function. Recall, in a previous lecture, we have seen C calling conventions. You push the arguments onto the stack before calling a function. Therefore, you push a pointer to this trap frame onto the stack, and you call the C trap handling function, right? So now this is the C trap handling function. It takes an argument as the trap frame, which has been pushed onto the kernel stack. And now this C code will handle the logic for whatever needs to be done to process the event, right? If it is a system call, if it is a device interrupt, if it is a program fault, whatever needs to be done, the C code does it. So I hope the role of all traps is clear. All traps simply builds a trap frame, pushes a pointer to that trap frame also onto the stack as an argument, and then calls the C trap handling function. Now this C trap handling function has the trap frame as an argument. The trap frame has the trap number. By looking at this trap number, this code does various things, right? So this trap number, the argument to int n is available. For example, if this trap number is a system call, then it will call the system call code, okay? So the system call code is shown here. Again, it's in a different part of the XV6 code. Right, so the system call code will look at the EAX register. Recall that if you remember the code in usys.s, you can go back and look at it. The system call number is there in the EAX register. The value of EAX register is stored in the trap frame. So using that information, you find out which system call it is. Is it fork? Is it exec? Whatever it is. And go call that, invoke that function. And the return value of that function is once again stored in EAX, right? So this is the system call handling. So in a previous lecture, we have seen that whenever a user process makes a system call, the int n instruction is invoked. That int n instruction will run this C trap function, which will call the system call function, which will look at the value in EAX and invoke. So all the system calls are defined in this array of function pointers, and the corresponding system call is invoked, right? This is the chain of events leading to the execution of a system call code, whether it is fork or exec or whatever in the kernel, right? So this is how a system call is handled. What about other kind of traps? If it's an interrupt from a device, for example, if it is a keyboard interrupt, then the corresponding keyboard interrupt handler is called. If it is a function from a disk, so IDE is the disk handler, then the disk related interrupt is called. If it is a timer interrupt, so timer is the special piece of hardware that every periodically, you can set a certain time period, it will keep raising interrupts, right? So this is useful for the operating system to keep track of time, to see if a process has run for too long. Whenever a timer interrupt occurs, a process that has been running is context switched out, the scheduler sees, has this guy run for too long, should I run somebody else? So this is just a general housekeeping kind of a call for the operating system. So whenever a timer interrupt occurs, you will, increment some time counter and do various things, right? In this way, based on the kind of the device, you switch based on the trap number, and the C trap handling function invokes various pieces of code depending on what the trap is. So on timer interrupt, if you look later in the code, if it is a timer interrupt, it will also call the function yield, right? So this is basically a process yielding the CPU. If a process has run for the entire duration of a time slice and a timer interrupt has occurred, then the process says, okay, I've run for long enough. I will set my state to runnable from running and give up the CPU. We've seen this code before. Right. So in this way, a timer interrupt also causes a process to yield the CPU to see if, I've had my share. If anybody else wants to run on the CPU, please go ahead. Right. So process is just being polite and giving up the CPU whenever a timer interrupt occurs. So these are all parts of the C trap handling function. You can go back and read it fully for more details. But basically, depending on the kind of trap, it does various different things. So now, the int n instruction has run, it came to the all traps function, the all trap function built the trap frame and it called the C trap handling function, and this trap handling function did whatever it had to do to handle the trap. Now, what happens after this? You come back to trap ret, right? The code returns and you come to this piece of code called trap ret. What does trap ret do? It is simply reverse whatever has been done. It will pop all the state from the track, from the stack. It will basically undo whatever context has been saved on the kernel stack. It will pop all of that, restore all of it back, into the corresponding registers, and it will invoke this function iret, which is basically the inverse of int, right? Iret will decrement the privilege level, pop the ESP, pop the EIP, whatever has been pushed by int, iret will undo all of that. And at the end of all of this, you return back to whatever you were doing, whatever was the pre-trap code that was there, that can resume, right? All the context that has been saved is popped out in the trap crate. So what happens on a trap? Int an instruction is run, you jump into kernel code, you handle the trap, and using the iret instruction, you go back, right? So this is the summary of XV6 trap handling. Any of these events, system calls, program faults, hardware interrupts, any of these will cause the CPU to stop whatever instruction it is running and execute the int n instruction instead. And this is a special instruction which will trap into the operating system code. So this instruction changes the CPU privilege level, will jump into the set the EIP to the kernel all traps function, will switch the ESP to the kernel stack, it will do all of these things and start executing kernel trap handling code with a secure kernel stack setup to push context. Then the pre-trap, whatever is the CPU's context state has to be saved, that is saved on the kernel stack. Some part of it is saved by the int instruction itself, things like ESP, EIP, and the rest of the registers are saved by the all traps code, with the result that the kernel stack has the trap frame on it. Okay, so the trap frame is set up on the kernel stack. And now the kernel trap handler, the C code runs, and the trap is handled, whatever processing needs to be done, if it's a disk event, a keyboard event, whatever needs to be done is done. And then you return. You once again, whatever state has been saved is all popped from the kernel stack, restored. So you go back and resume to whatever you were doing before the trap occurred. For example, if a process was running some code, it made a system call, you'll go back. The system call returns, you'll go back and you'll do whatever you were doing before the trap occurred. So this is a summary of how XV6 handles traps. And this understanding is important. Every time you think of an interrupt or a system call or a program fault happening, know that all of this story is happening in the background via the special trap instruction.